My name is Cyril Vijayasundara. I'm a member of the National Man and Biosphere Committee. In fact, about five, six years ago, the National Committee of UNESCO asked the MAP Committee, of which I'm a member, to design or plan for a geopark. And I like to thank UNESCO and also the Japanese Geoparks Commission or Committee for inviting me and letting me participate in this very wonderful workshop, and I wish I participated this kind of workshop about 5 years ago, because things I have learned that I could have used, and I could have come a long way in preparation of the dossier. When the NACCOM Sri Lanka wanted us to do the geopark thing, they made a committee and I was a member. Two other professors, one of them was a geologist and the other one was a ecologist, I'm a botanist by the way. And we were planning this thing. And before that, for those of you who don't know where the Sri Lanka is, it's at the tip of India. The big part is India and Sri Lanka is an island at the southern tip. And we were planning to have a geopark in the southern part of Sri Lanka. That's where the dot is here, and it's about 300 acre long big serpentine site. The whole area is like this, red in color. There are serpentine deposits. In fact, it's on a fold between two different rock types. It called the Vijayan series and Highland series. So it's on the fold. So along the fold, you have very interesting formations, nickel deposits and also some things I know, and also hot springs further away. And originally, we were thinking of having only this geosite as a geopark. Now, after coming here and after talking to Patrick, I thought that, you know, it has to be a bigger one. And then we have to include other areas like hot spring and also some fossil sites, natural parks and a bit of a Ramsar site and also a bit of an IBR also. Anyway, the challenges we have are actually lack of opportunities, so insufficient opportunities to do a lot of research on geology and other areas. Because geology, sorry to say, that has not been taken as an exciting research science subject. People go for various other natural science research, plants, animals and other things, but it's kind of dull subject for many people. So we have to make it more attractive and interesting and then create more research opportunities. There's also a tendency in our country to fund applied research, and we have to persuade and get more funding to do basic science, fundamental research. By the way, I work for the Institute of Fundamental Studies as a professor. And one of our problems is finding money to do fundamental science research. And also, there are a lot of threats from various sectors. They are trying to put up various structures in these sites to attract. There are a lot of tourists visiting this area, and to attract tourists or to cater to tourists, people are trying to put up some hotels and other things on the sensitive areas. So that's a problem. And also, we don't know what's happening due to the climate change, where different weathering activities enhanced, or whether we lose some of those sensitive sites. And also, people in the area don't know the influence, I mean, the importance of these sites. There are, I mean, hot springs are being used, but people don't know why there are hot springs and what are the geological importance of it, and also these sites and things. There are a lot of mythological things, you know, people have so many stories and so many myths. Explaining the origin of these unusual sites and things, but of cultural importance, and there are some prehistoric tools and things discovered in this area, but people are not aware. So the awareness, lack of awareness is a problem, and also this belongs, this area and also the other areas of the aspiring geosite, geopark. Has so many owners: wildlife department, forest department, archaeology department, the provincial or local government, So since there are so many stakeholders involved, we have to talk to each other and then get them into a common table. So that's one thing we have to think of. And then also for the roadmap, I thought it's better we have to compile more information. We have to look for other areas of the geopark which we are thinking of getting into or into this expansion. And also networking, that has been the keyword used by many presenters I heard. And this is again not just networking in the country, even in the region or even at a bigger level, because we can even learn from the geoparks in the region, our closer neighbors. Not you know, going all the way to Japan, but there are other people who are in the vicinity. And also we can get geologists and botanists and ecologists, zoologists, all these people, economists into this system. And also for the policy makers and local government and provincial government leaders, we have to make them aware. We have to contaminate them with this geopark bug. So we have to have these dialogues and make the local community aware. Awareness can be using symposia, workshops and things. In fact, when I will go back, I will get the national committee, the MME committee to rethink this whole idea and even summon a kind of a workshop or symposium to gather more information and also to inform the other people about this. Now the world is in our court, we can't get the national committee to form a committee or something. So it has, they have already given us the task and it's up to us. And also, I think it's good to have a kind of participatory approach. Now when you start doing this kind of things in our country, there are so many so-called nature-loving NGOs who always see something bad in it. They think, okay, there must be something, some kind of international conspiracy or some, you know, some multinational companies trying to get something out of it and some biopiracy or this and that. By the way, our country is very rich in biodiversity, so people are very cautious. There are good things and bad things about this globalization and, you know, communication and this and that, but then there are so many different NGOs who are always trying to see, yes, anything, what is the catch or something like that. So we have to get them on board. Our always, when we do something, we always try to get these people also on board and then make them also stakeholders. So make them also aware that there is nothing hidden, there is no hidden agenda. It is done only for the common good, for the economic development of the community and the people living nearby. So this participatory approach is, I think, very important in our case at least. Thank you very much.